Well, good day, everyone, everywhere, and special greetings to everyone seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, our Messiah. The name of this broadcast is Cross the Border, and I'm Nicholas, your host. Today is our once a week, yes, Prophecy Reality Edition. The studio cam is on, and we are live if you're listening on Tuesday evening at 8 p.m. Otherwise, if you're listening on Wednesday morning, it's a rebroadcast or any other time. So if you are listening live on Tuesday evening at 8 p.m. Pacific time, that would be 11 p.m. over on the other Eastern seaboard, then come over to the chat room and join my three faithful listeners who are in there with me. Okay, yes, and we are live streaming on YouTube also. So, but there's a little YouTube player in the right-hand column of the chat page where you can join us. Okay, what are we going to talk about today? We have a couple. Today we're going to do our fourth installment of The Key to the Apocalypse. And I think what I'm going to do is, we have published this Key to the Apocalypse. You can actually buy a paperback version of this, but don't fret. You can get a free copy right now and then join me on the air. But anyway, we're going to finish up that today. Part four is going to cover it, The Key to the Apocalypse. So you're going to want to stick around for that. That's the main body of the show. But before we do that, I wanted to make an announcement. And while I'm at my home page here, if you scroll down to the second or the whatever, one of these, there it is right there, one of the latest posts. And you'll find out that I actually published my latest book. I told you it would be early this year, and here we are almost 3 weeks into January, and I finally got it published. So, and the title of it is When the Third Temple is Built. And so you're going to want to get a copy of that. And again, you know, I'm not a great businessman here, so you'll see links on the page how you get a free copy if you want a free copy of it. If you want a paperback, unfortunately, I don't have a printing press here. So, you know, there's a link there, or you can click on the cover itself, and it'll link you to the guys with the printing press. And they'll send you a copy if you want to read one. But there it is. You can get an e-copy from me free by following the instructions there on that page. So that's it. When the Third Temple is Built, the Rapture Play Will Begin. And, you know, I thought about the title, and I decided to just go with the one that says it the best. This is what the book is about. And it's about a lot more than that. Let me read my statement here for you. I guess I'm going to have to put on my glasses to read this here. Okay. Most of the evangelical and Christian world today believes that the coming of Christ is imminent and that they will be raptured away before all of the calamity of the entire book of Revelation ensues during the very last 7 or 3.5 years of this era, a period of great tribulation unlike any other in the history of the world. Yes, indeed. As the world around us shapes to confirm that we are indeed living in the time of the very end, many are beginning to look deeper into the Bible, and more specifically, the prophetic passages of Jesus, the epistles, and the Revelation. This has caused many to lay down the pre-tribulation rapture doctrine because of the shaky ground on which it is founded. What I've found out is that the error and deception goes much deeper than one would think upon entering this sojourn. So please, take a break. Let go and seriously consider the things that I expose in this continued investigation into the false as well as the unknown or forgotten interpretations of Bible prophecy. This book is by no means a complete expose of Bible prophecy, but merely a teaser, an appetizer, to induce you to look where the mainstream Christian world is not looking. May the Almighty bless you as you seek a Holy Spirit interpretation of his prophetic passages. And that's exactly what we're getting into today with our dive into The Key to the Apocalypse, another book you should have in your collection. Also available, yeah, you guessed it, right here at firstamendmentradio.com or crossborder.org, specifically speaking. And look for that page, Key to the Apocalypse, and you can get a free copy of all of these, or you can purchase a copy, whatever your desire is. Some people like to, you know, sit under by their lamp late into the night. Well, that's me. You know, I like to sit there with the paperback copy. I got, you know, the history of apocalyptic interpretation. Got all my prophecy books and more, because I like to read fiction too. You know, I like Louis L'Amour, and there's some other great fiction out there that I like. So, and I like to sit into the night. I'm even reading Pilgrim's Progress right now. Or I should say rereading Pilgrim's Progress right now at the same time. I've always got three or four books cracked. So it's a good habit to get into. Yes, what if computers disappear and you'd lose your entire library if you don't have one that's in print? So anyway, that's just me. I'll look out for that lapel mic there. Okay. Well, before we move on to the Key to the Apocalypse, I got a few news items we're going to cover here, and then we'll jump into it and we'll finish that off tonight. Let's see, my news items. First one is, I think I mentioned, I don't know if I mentioned, well, I was looking at before the weekend anyway, I don't think I mentioned it, about the Paris Peace Conference. A lot of people probably heard about that. These 70 countries showed up without Hamas or Israel, and they were going to have a Mideast peace conference. Well, here's the big headlines for you. Anti-Israel, because it was anti-Israel, Paris conference ends with a whimper, not a bang. It says not bang. I think they meant not a bang. I see a lot of errors in news these days. It's interesting anyway. And anyway, this is on CBN News. I use their one, and I'm not really going to read it or anything. It's just there if you're interesting. Like I said, it ends with a whimper, not a bang. I think I read the Israeli Times or Jerusalem Post, I think it was. It says, much ado about nothing. That's what they thought about it. So anyway, but we have one other news item, and this one is somewhat more interesting. This is a Donald Trump's son-in-law to broker Middle East peace. Interesting. Is this guy, you know, this guy looks like he could even, yeah, let me put this on here. This guy even looks like, you know, the Damien character. You know, I hate to say that about anybody. But, you know, because I mean, just the Damien character in the movies and the books, you know, he's a real handsome young guy, you know, that they put up for the Antichrist. This guy looks like he could fit the bill. Who knows? And anyway, just, you know, maybe something just to chuckle about. I'm not really serious about that. But, you know, these futurists, whoever makes the peace deal that includes building the Temple Mount, oh my God, that poor guy. He's going to be the Antichrist of the 7-year tribulation left behind eschatology. Yeah. The guy they're waiting for. So kind of feel sorry for this guy. If he works it out, they build this temple. Anyway, that's what my book's about, when they build the temple, because it seems like this is the time that it's going to happen. You're going to want to get this book and my latest book. It seems that God has given me good timing on it. But anyway, I do want to read this article. There's not a whole lot here. So here you have this handsome young 36-year-old guy. Yeah, looks like he could be the one. Okay, President-elect Donald Trump says his son-in-law, Jared Kushner, will work to broker a Middle East peace deal. In an interview with the Times of London, Trump said that Kushner, Ivanka Trump's husband, would be tasked with negotiating peace between Israel and the Palestinians. Trump has said Kushner, who has no previous diplomatic experience, knows the religion. Yeah, I'll say he does. Knows the people. Knows the players. Sounds like he's right in there and up on it all, right? Kushner is reported to have been the primary drafter of Trump's speech to the American Israel Public Affairs Committee, which drew praise. Israel's defense minister, Avigdor Lieberman, has called Kushner a really tough, smart guy. Imagine that. Really tough, smart guy. Dennis Ross, a senior Middle East diplomat in three USS, USS? I don't think that's supposed to be three USS. I think it's supposed to be US, USS. Maybe they're trying to give us a clue here. United Soviet States or United Socialist States, yes. I think that's a misprint there, or perhaps what do you call it? Anyway, we'll read it the way it should have been read, I guess. A senior Mideast diplomat in three U.S. administrations told the Jerusalem Post he clearly is someone who has a sense of Jewish identity. I wonder why. And he is someone who has a genuine attachment to Israel and understanding of the importance of U.S.-Israel relationships. Kushner has was raised in an Orthodox Jewish home, and his grandparents were Holocaust survivors. Trump's daughter, Ivanka, converted to Orthodox Judaism when they married. How unusual, yeah. See, if Ivanka was Catholic, see, Kushner would have had to convert to Catholicism, but I guess because she's not. And yeah, anyway, enough said about that. But it's getting very interesting on the Israel front there and the Mideast peace negotiation thing that's going to be starting up here. So yes, it's very likely that we may see this thing get off the ground. And we'll see who the futurists label the Antichrist. Of course, we know that it's not really the Antichrist, but they will believe it's the Antichrist. So it's going to be very interesting. And it just makes me think of a couple chapters in my book. Get a free copy of my book. And the instructions are on the page on how to do that. Maybe we'll talk about it again in a few minutes or something. But right now, that's all the news I got for you today on the prophecy front. So let's jump into Key to the Apocalypse. Okay, here we are, Key to the Apocalypse. We left off on page 83. Yeah, 83, last week. And I'm going to back up just a little bit so we get the continuity. And this ending, the statement we finished up with last week was just really a good statement. Let's see if I can scoot that over there a little bit. And let's see. Okay, looked at in this comprehensive way, the apocalypse may be considered as a prophet continued in the Church of God. So you kind of wonder why we don't have more prophets like the Old Testament prophets. This is the reason why. So I'm going to start that again. When I read this the first time and I read it finished up, I wanted a little more time to emphasize this point. So pay attention. Looked at in this comprehensive way, the apocalypse, that is the book of Revelation, may be considered as a prophet continued in the Church of God, uttering predictions which have their successive fulfillments as ages roll on. And thus it stands in the Christian church in the place of a succession of prophets in the Jewish nation. And by this special economy, prophecy is still continued, is always speaking, and yet a succession of prophets is rendered unnecessary. Okay, let's continue here on page 83 of Key to the Apocalypse. The four great empires of prophecy plainly agree with the four great empires of history. Their number is the same. their order is the same. They have the same commencing point and the same course, character, and termination. The first kingdom of Ptolemy and Daniel is the Babylonian. The second, the Medo-Persian. The third, the Grecian. The fourth, the Roman. Daniel doubly represents these four empires, one by four distinct metallic parts of a single image, Daniel chapter 2. Two, by four successive wild beasts, chapter 7 of Daniel. The fourth kingdom of Daniel reappears three times in the Apocalypse of John. While the fifth kingdom of Daniel, the eternal kingdom of the God of heaven, is the terminal kingdom of the Apocalypse. The kingdom of the mountain in Daniel 2, represented as the kingdom of the Son of Man and of the saints in Daniel 7, is identical with the kingdom of Christ and the saints in Revelation 20 through 22. These identifications of the five kingdoms rests on divinely given interpretations of the symbolic visions by which they are portrayed. Further, the three great visions of the fourth empire in the Apocalypse represent successive stages in its history. The first of these represents the Roman Empire under the regnancy of its crowned heads. The second under the regnancy of its crowned horns. The third as carrying the harlot Babylon, whom it subsequently casts off and destroys. These three great visions in Revelation 12, 13, and chapter 17 are closely linked with all of the remaining visions in the Apocalypse. Their divinely interpreted connection with the history of the Roman Empire is the key to the entire prophecy. The harlot seated on the beast is Papal Rome. From this interpretation of its central vision follows the interpretation of the whole Apocalypse. History confirms and illustrates what the prophecy foretells. And that's the page, the end of that, of chapter 6. Moving on to chapter 7, and this is the addendum that I wrote, yes, out of my own brain with my own keyboard. Yes, with my own pen and paper, or my typewriter. I've used a typewriter in the past. Yes, I'm ancient, probably compared to most people listening to this broadcast. Yes, I've actually used a typewriter and typed things up. Right, I still have a typewriter, although it hasn't been used in a very long time. My daughter has played with it. She thinks it's cool, you know, putting paper in there and pounding it out on keys. Yeah, something else. Anyway, let's see. You know what? We're going to pick up on the addendum after we get back from a break. Okay. You're listening to Cross the Border. This is our Prophecy Reality Edition, and we are finishing up on the Key to the Apocalypse. You can get a free copy of the Key to the Apocalypse. Go to my website, crosstheborder.org, and subscribe there. If you're already a subscriber, yeah, you can get a copy too. You just have to request it. If you've read my book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled, I'm going to ask you to write a review on Amazon. The links are there on the free ebook tab at crosstheborder.org. Instructions on how to get a copy of The Rapture Will Be Canceled, Key to the Apocalypse, and other works that you'll find there in the same directory that I will send you upon completing your subscription, or once again, writing the review if you've already got a free copy and you're already a subscriber. Okay, we'll be back in a few minutes. Don't go anywhere.
The program you are listening to is 100% sponsored by you, the listener, on this First Amendment Rights Media channel. You will notice that there are few commercials on this radio network. There's a good reason for that. Corporate advertising dollars come with strings that limit program content. So without your help, these programs cannot continue on internet or our several affiliates. If you benefit by the educational law programs, we ask you to give. If you are admonished or nurtured by the Bible and ministry programs, we ask you to give. If some voice a cause that you are passionate about, we ask you to give. If you believe in any of these, we ask you to support them as you would a missionary on a continual basis, as if giving a tithe for missionary radio. These programs are not commercially viable and must be supported by those faithful to the cause of truth. Look for the button to sponsor your favorite programs at our listen and schedule pages on the internet. Then, when you subscribe, we will send you the last quarterly MP3 CD of that program immediately and continue to do so with each new quarter. We will also give you unlimited archive access to all of our programs. We're asking you to give much less than a tithe so that you may also send support directly to a particular program host, cause, and anywhere else the Spirit may lead you. Do all to the glory of our God and Creator, for His holy nation, the only kingdom that will last forever. Thank you for listening.
The book of Revelation says, "The spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus Christ." This is at the very heart of FirstAmendmentRadio.com. In that spirit, we have created the Prophecy Reality News app for all of your mobile devices, streaming First Amendment Radio 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Available for your Apple, Android device, and smartphone, absolutely free. Get the Prophecy Reality News app installed today, so you can listen to First Amendment Radio wherever you are. The Prophecy Reality News app. Get it now. Welcome back. You're listening to Across the Border. This is our Prophecy Reality News Edition. Anyway, maybe I ought to make a YouTube video and call it September 23rd, 2017. What's going to happen? And I can get 500,000 views in no time, just like that. Wow, maybe I should do that. No, don't go watch that video right now. I'm doing a show here for you. Okay, just having fun with the people in the chat room there. Thank you all for listening, whether you're listening live, later on, YouTube, podcasts, rebroadcast, however you're listening. Just want to thank you for showing up. And I don't know how these people do it. They get, you know, tens of thousands of subscribers, hundreds of thousands of subscribers. And I guess I just don't know how to be popular and famous. Can someone write a book about that? Maybe I could get a clue. Well, until then, I guess I'll just keep doing the wrong thing. Yeah. What is obviously not working. And I will laugh about it as I do it. Yes, we'll see who has the last laugh. Okay, here we go. Back into it. Okay, Key of the Apocalypse. We're in Chapter 7. And it's got a date on it. Addendum. Maybe I'll just call my video Addendum 2017. Yeah, wonder what people think of that. Yes, it's because it's an addendum to the Key to the Apocalypse. Because our good friend, and I'll just read it here. This is page 86 if you're following along. Since H. Grattan Guinness, the author of the original Key to the Apocalypse, who did, you know, 90% of this work for me already, right? I thought it was worth republishing. I hope everyone else thinks so. Since H. Grattan Guinness published the original Key in 1899, yes, a short 115 years ago, several events have become abundantly clear in the history of the revelation. So these are key points which he could not take into account because they had not happened yet. That's right. One, the Vatican or papacy, the head that was wounded on effect of the French Revolution and all of the machinations that followed that, that wound was healed in 1929 when the Vatican once again regained its sovereign political status on the world stage and has moved to a prominent position amongst all nations. Yeah, before that, you know, they had their Jesuit army out there working in all the nations, of course, but they were subjects of Italy. They were like, you know, a mega church in Italy. That's what the Vatican was like before it regained its sovereign status. But it did regain its sovereign status in 1929 and has moved to a prominent position among the nations. Number two, the status of America on the world stage has greatly increased to an undeniable place of prominence and power among the nations. Yes. Is that important? Well, we'll figure that out by the end of this chapter. Three, the United Nations has been created as a worldwide governing authority, which continues to increase in power over the nations. Section one here. Interpreting the earth beast of Revelation 13 by the criteria in divinely given interpretations of the four preceding beasts as revealed in Daniel and the Apocalypse. Yes, thank the Heavenly Father. Give me a little more meat to put on the bones of prophecy here and directly from divinely given interpretations. See, not only has... is the key of the Apocalypse a great reference source, but it's a good teacher on how to interpret prophecy too. So that's why this is such a great work and everyone should have it in the library. I mean, you should buy the paperback. Yeah, absolutely. But anyway, here we are, interpreting the earth beast of Revelation 13 by the criteria in divinely given interpretations of the four preceding beasts as revealed in Daniel and the Apocalypse. Daniel 7, 3 through 6. And four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse from one another. The first beast was like a lion, and the second like unto a bear, and the third like a leopard. Compare this with Revelation 13, 1. And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea. See, we have here, up from the sea, up out of the sea. So if we're getting an interpretation for this, then we realize that there is something that is the same here. And these interpretations should be interpreted the same. So if God gives us an interpretation for this symbol of a beast rising up from the sea, we should pay attention and apply it universally. I think that might be a good idea. Okay, so Revelation 13:1, and I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. We notice that all of these beasts come up from the same place, the sea. We also notice that all of these beast powers were original in themselves and only incorporated the others when they conquered them consecutively. The fourth beast devours the three beasts that were before it, and therefore it inherits the attributes of the three beasts before it. From verse 2 of chapter 13, leopard, bear, and lion. And if you'll remember from our previous page in the Daniel 7, 3 through 6, it said, the first was like a lion, the second like a bear, and the third like a leopard. See, something's going on here. Hey, so the fourth beast devours the three beasts that were before it, and therefore inherits the attributes of the three before it. leopard, bear, and lion. 1. Each of these sea beasts, as they were introduced, was an original power in the earth. This is true. For all of these, they were original powers in the earth. That one swallowed up the three that were before it. It was original before it swallowed the three, though. So they were, all of these beasts, these sea beasts, were original powers in the earth. I want to drive that point home. Our second point here, any division of a beast may be represented by the introduction of horns and crowns in succession as you move from the body toward the heads and horns, and the body is always the same beast. Right? And we had like Alexander the Great. He was the he-goat. Was he represented as a he-goat? That's right. With one notable horn. Remember that guy? Yes. And that was Alexander the Great, the he-goat, with one notable horn. Okay? He had one notable horn. And then that horn was broken off, but it was still the same beast. And four horns came up in its place. Right? And that was because his kingdom, when he died suddenly, his kingdom was partitioned between his four generals. And that's what it represents. And that's what the divinely given interpretation to that prophecy, because God gave the prophecy and he gave the interpretation. And that's exactly what it was. Okay, so any division of beasts may be represented by the introduction of horns and crowns in succession as you move from the body towards the heads, horns, and the body is always the same beast. Okay. Point number 3, that these beasts rose up from the sea signifies that they all rose up from the same locality that was ultimately dominated by the Roman Empire, the fourth beast of Daniel 7 and the sea beast of Revelation 13. This is the locality specified for the origin of all the sea beasts. Okay, so there's something to be learned by this here. And from these, well, rules of interpretation, you know, because these rules come from divinely given interpretation. So we know that because the interpretation is sure. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth. Remember the other ones, all of the four before it came up out of the sea. This one's different. It comes up out of the earth. So its origin is up out of the earth. Revelation 13:11. 1. The earth beast is for the first time introduced as an original power at the same time when the sea beast has 10 horns and upon his horns 10 crowns and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. The earth beast is not a division of the sea beast. 2. The earth beast did not rise up from the same locality as any of the sea beasts. Thus, we must not look at the area of dominion of the Old World Roman Empire for its place of origin. On page 88, if you're trying to catch up. We must first look at the direct description and attributes of this earth beast given in the text to determine its origin and identity. 1. It is described as coming up out of the earth. This would be a clue as to its place of origin, as the symbolic earth is different from the symbolic sea, where the four previous beasts rose up, inasmuch as actual earth or land is an opposite or different than sea or waters. We are given the interpretation of the symbolic waters in chapter 17, peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. In searching for a clearly symbolic use of the word earth in the Revelation, this author could only find one other reference. And earth is used a lot in the book of Revelation, but there's only one other place besides here where it's symbolically, the beast symbolically rises up out of the earth. See, that's a symbolic earth, okay? Inasmuch as the symbolic sea is the place where the other four beasts rose up. So being used clearly as a symbol in those two instances in chapter 13. And we find that in chapter 17, the waters, which we equate to the seas, is symbolic of peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. So we're given an interpretation for symbolic waters, and we apply that to seas. Okay? So we're looking for a clearly symbolic use of the word earth in the Revelation. And I could only find one. And if you're following along, you see it here. It's Revelation 12:16, where it says, "And the earth helped the woman, and the earth opened her mouth." Clearly symbolic use. Okay? It doesn't, you know, when a vial is poured out in the earth, that's not symbolic. The vial is symbolic. The earth is the earth. Okay? We're looking for a clearly symbolic use of the word. And this is the only other one except for the where it's used in chapter 13. Okay? Clearly symbolic. Here, the earth helped the woman. That's symbolic. Because the earth is benign. It doesn't help anybody. It's just what it is. You know, it's planet Earth. Yes, it's not spinning though. But that's another story. We won't even go there today. Okay? So the earth opened up her mouth, clearly symbolic, and swallowed up the flood which the dragon cast out of his mouth. Driven that point home, I hope. Okay. The woman was spared from the dragon war on the remnant of her seed by a prepared place in the wilderness for the time, times, and half a time. Okay? That's what's going on in Revelation chapter 12, where the symbolic earth helped the woman and opened up her mouth and swallowed up the flood which the dragon cast out of his mouth. Okay? The woman was spared from the dragon war on the remnant of her seed by a prepared place in the wilderness for the time and times and half a time. This prepared place would have been outside the governmental sphere of the old world Roman Empire. So the conclusion would be that the symbolic sea represents a locality that is densely populated, peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. So the symbolic earth would represent the opposite, a locality that is a wilderness or was sparsely populated when the earth beast had its origin. When a tenth part of the papal kingdom fell, which tenth EBL identifies as the falling away of Protestant England from the papal states, remember the ten horns? Mm-hmm. Okay. And we covered that in the Key to the Apocalypse, what the ten horns represent. One of those horns was the papal state. It fell away. Okay. And remember, this is at the time, chapter 13, when the ten horns have ten crowns, right? I believe that's exactly what it says. Okay. And what happens is the earth beast rises up. Jumping back here, when a tenth part of the papal kingdom fell, which tenth E.B. Eliot identifies as the falling away of Protestant England from the papal states, many had been fleeing to the New World to escape persecution and papal inquisition in the same place where Protestant England eventually established 13 colonies. Canada to the north was a crown colony of the sovereign city of London. Yes, one of the three cities of the Empire of the Cities, or the city. Mexico, down through all of South America, Latin America, was conquered on behalf of the Vatican by the papal vassals of Portugal and Spanish conquistadors. In the New World, the only power that rose up and came to exhibit all the attributes of the Revelation 13 earth beast is the one that developed out of the 13 colonies planted by Protestant England, the United States of America. 2. The earth beast had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon, Revelation 13:11. these two horns demonstrate two equal and opposing powers. Two equal and opposing powers at the origin of this beast, lamb-like and draconic in speech. The American Continental Congress adopted the Articles of Confederation, the first Constitution of the United States, on November 15, 1777. The present Constitution of the United States was written during the Constitutional Convention. Those that opposed it were able to get the Bill of Rights attached to it to preserve those liberties. It was signed on September 17th, 1787. Very important point here. F. Tupper Saucy, in his book, Rulers of Evil, unquestionably exposes the hidden, secret influence in the establishment of the U.S. Constitution, and more specifically, the concentration of power in the newly created head of this beast. Remember, two horns, it must have a head. And here's the newly created head of the beast, the sovereign city of the District of Columbia, one of the three cities of the empire. Isn't that interesting? Here we have, wow, just very interesting. Here we have the Vatican, the sovereign city, falling, losing one of its ten horns, right? Yes, a tenth of the kingdom fell. That was Protestant England falling away from the ten-horned kingdom empire of the papal states. But what did the Vatican establish? The city of London, the banking center of the world, a sovereign city in the midst of a Protestant state. Isn't that interesting? And that Protestant state goes on and becomes the seed of a great nation in the New World. Another Protestant state. But what does this Protestant state also have? Another sovereign city created by the Vatican. Wow! And, I mean, you get into the cities of the empire of the city, the unholy trinity that rules the world. This is, and I'm going to I got some rewriting to do on that article. One of the most popular articles on my website now for years is The Empire of the City, the unholy trinity that rules the world, always in the top two or three being viewed on my website. I'm going to update it now because of, you know, what God has revealed here, and I can add a little more to it. And yes. Something else. But anyway, just thinking about what this dragon power was able to do, even when and this is the hidden hand of the Jesuit power, of the Jesuit army of the Vatican. This is their hidden hand at work, even in the midst corrupting the only Protestant state, the first Protestant state that broke away from the Vatican hold over the old world, and even in that new nation created on all of those godly principles. And I'll tell you what, if those guys hadn't got that Bill of Rights, guess what? I wouldn't be here today, right now, speaking these things to you. You would not have a gun. Okay, you would not be able to have a gun, and all of the rights, the free speech, all of that that you enjoy was because there were a few guys that stood up and said, nah, we don't believe that they will allow us to retain these rights. This Constitution will not pass without this Bill of Rights attached to it. Yeah, there it is. That's one horn, and the other horn was the rest of the Constitution, basically, which all sounded good. But it was that concentration of power and the creation of that third city-state of the city, of the empire of the city that rules the world. But anyway, F. Tupper Saucy in his book, page 90, continuing. And I guess we're going to have to continue when we get back from the break, because we're about a minute away. And I hope everyone's enjoying the broadcast here today. Yes, yes, people are actually quitting in the chat room. But that means that they're listening and they don't really care about the chat room. Okay, you can get a copy of this book and that we're going through right now. And that is Key to the Apocalypse. And if you read this once, you'll want to read it two or three times. It's less than 100 pages. And you'll definitely want to read it more, many times. And so, because once you absorb it, and then it'll become, wow, it'll become crystal, well, it'll become very clear, if not crystal clear to you. It's like, bing, yeah, God gave us the interpretation. All we have to do is learn how to apply it and understand the divine interpretation that God gave us as a key to understand the rest of his prophecy. Yes, the key to the apocalypse. You're listening to Cross the Border, our prophecy reality edition. We're going to have a little music, some news. So don't go anywhere. Get a cup of coffee, whatever you need, and come on back. About 7 minutes.
Visit crosstheborder.org, CROSS, crosstheborder.org, to get your print, EPUB, or PDF version of the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. That's crosstheborder.org.
I know you all want answers, and believe me, so do I, and I'll do my best to get them.
Despite Nicolas Cage's promise to do his best to get left behind rapture answers for us, don't hold your breath. Not everyone believes Left Behind is true prophecy. Some may even regard as conspiratorial the mainstream re-release of the Left Behind movie with actor Nicolas Cage portraying the main character as an attempt to further reinforce in the minds of all this perception of false prophecy in order to condition the masses for the play about to begin. If you want true Bible prophecy answers, get the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. The author exposes the Latin rapture origin, the seven-year tribulation deception, true Bible revelation of Daniel's 70 weeks, the abomination of desolation, the restrainer, America in the revelation, the image of the beast and the mark of the beast, and the truth about God's chosen people, and so much more about Bible prophecy. This book will shatter the left behind paradigm of future events. Get the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. Visit crosstheborder.org, CROSS, crosstheborder.org, to get your print, EPUB, or PDF version of the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. That's crosstheborder.org.
Welcome back. You're listening to Cross the Border. This is our Prophecy Reality Edition, and we are going to finish up on Key to the Apocalypse pretty soon here. And we left off, well, let's see, before we left off, maybe I should let you know that you can get a PDF copy of the Key to the Apocalypse absolutely free. If you haven't subscribed to my website, all you have to do is go to crosstheborder.org and let's see, how do you do this here, desktop, there it is. Go to crosstheborder.org, and if you go to the top, there's a free ebook tab here. All you gotta do is click on that, and then you follow the instructions there to get a copy of my book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. If you already have the, if you've already read The Rapture to the Will Be Canceled, and you've already subscribed to my website, then I'm going to ask you to click on this link here where it says, please leave a review, and leave a review on Amazon for The Rapture Will Be Canceled. And once you've done that, then feel free to download or ask for another link to download The Key to the Apocalypse. There, and there's a link to the page there, to one of those pages, Key to the Apocalypse. And I'll send you a new link to get that. If you're a new subscriber, all of those books will be available for you there. Okay, so don't want to, if you can't afford it or whatever, or you would rather read on your iPad or whatever you have, then yeah, ebook will work fine for you. If you'd like a paperback copy of any of these books, well, then you can get a copy of that. I think if you go to my go to my homepage and scroll down just a little bit, you'll find the my newly published book there, When the Third Temple is Built, The Rapture Play Will Begin. You'll definitely want to get a copy of that. That's also free ebook copy available to everyone. And right here it says click to purchase the paperback. So if you click on that link there or any of the covers, it'll take you to my author spotlight on Lulu Press there, and you can order, well, When the Temple is Built right there, Key to the Apocalypse there. Also have History of Apocalyptic Interpretation here, and of course there's the Hori Apocalypticae printed out for you there, but more specifically The Last Prophecy. That's the abridgment of E.B. Eliot's Hori Apocalypticae. I'd say get that before you get the four volumes of the Hori Apocalypticae. Very expensive. It's a very big book. They're like 600 pages each for those, or 500 to 600 pages each for those. So it's a lot of reading. Just get the abridgment. And then if you read through the abridgment and you say, oh, I just got to have that, you can get a free PDF. That's also in the library when you sign up for the free ebooks. You can get all these stuff in free PDFs. So nothing to it. And of course, if you click on this tab here where it says page 2, it'll take you back to my early... I have large print Bibles that I publish there for Across the Border. They're like 14 point, but they're big, you know. They're big Bibles. It was done in two volumes because they're so big. But not bad, you know. For $50, you can have, you know, a huge Bible, volume 1 and 2 there. And then you can also get, all of my books are available there at that same link. You just have to go back to get The Rapture Will Be Canceled onto the second page, because they put the newest volumes up on the top. So make sure you take advantage of them. But now, the moment everyone's been waiting for, right? Yes, not me. You want The Key to the Apocalypse. We're going to finish that up as soon as I find it. There it is. I'll put that on the screen. Okay, I'm going to back up a little bit. Yes, we talked about how the 10th part of the papal kingdom fell from E.B. Eliot. Says that was Protestant England falling away. Yes, one of the 10 horns fell away, because yeah, there was a great earthquake and a 10th of the kingdom fell. And I would agree with E.B. Eliot on that one. The earth beast had 2 horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. These 2 horns demonstrate 2 equal and opposing powers at the origin of this beast, lamb-like and draconic in speech. The American Continental Congress adopted the Articles of Confederation, the first Constitution of the United States, on November 15, 1777. The present Constitution for the United States was written during the Constitutional Convention. Those that opposed it were able to get the Bill of Rights attached to it to preserve those liberties, and thank God they did. I thank God to this very day. and attached to it to preserve those liberties. It was signed on September 17th, 1787. F. Tupper Saucy in his book, Rulers of Evil. And when you sign up for any of my free ebooks on the free ebook tab, you will find Rulers of Evil in that directory. An excellent resource. Everyone should have it. F. Tupper Saucy, in his book, Rulers of Evil, unquestionably exposes the hidden secret influence. And I'm not being redundant when I say hidden secret. Because kind of hidden in plain sight, but exposes the hidden secret influence in the establishment of the U.S. Constitution, and more specifically, the concentration of power in the newly created head of this beast. And that's why I know when the beast rose up. It was 1787 when they ratified that Constitution, because that's when the beast got its head, right? The sovereign city of the District of Columbia. And that is absolutely, there's nothing but, yes, papal when you see the name, the District of Columbia. Through this, though this power, and now we're speaking of the earth beast power, though this power was founded upon many godly or lamb-like principles, the draconic influence would eventually turn it to come alongside the draconic power of the sea beast that infected it at its inception. And you know, when the earth beast rose up, the sea beast, I mean the ten-horned beast, was in its phase where the crowns were on the horns rather than the heads. Okay. But now the phase is the whore is riding the beast and controlling the beast. And most of the people that are, you know, part of these, with under these beast powers, they don't even know it. They don't have a clue. You try to tell these people, they just laugh at you. The papacy, the Pope, the Antichrist, the world laughs, especially those that are have this, left behind futurist mindset. They think, oh, you're nuts. It's not the Pope, not that old guy. You know, some of them are starting to think, well, maybe there's something to that, you know, because with the rise of his popularity and everything. But they just laughed, you know, the last 20, 30 years, people just laugh at you. What, the Catholic Church, they're nothing, the papacy, that's, you know, they just kind of laugh at you. But the whore is riding the beast. That's the phase we're now. We're in that third phase where the whore is actually riding the beast, and it's riding it through these three, you know, remember, there was another great earthquake, and the city was divided into three parts. I believe that, because this earthquake, these earthquakes, these are political earthquakes. That's what, when there was a great earthquake and a tenth of the kingdom fell, that was a political earthquake. There was fallout from that. When the city was divided into three parts, yeah, that was a political earthquake. And I believe that is the division of the empire of the city and its three sovereign cities by which it rules the world, the Vatican, the sovereign city of London, and the sovereign city of the District of Columbia. And you read my article on my website at crosstheborder.org. Look in the right-hand column. It's in the trending articles there, and you'll see it. The empire of the city, the unholy trinity that rules the world. And maybe you'll get a clue. Okay, though this power is founded upon many godly or lamb-like principles, and we're speaking again still of the earth beast power, the draconic influence would eventually turn it to come alongside the draconic power of the sea beast that infected it at its inception. The history of this alliance between these two beasts is foretold in the 13th chapter of the Revelation. 3. The earth beast exercises all the power of the first beast before him and causes the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. Verse 12 of chapter 13. It is not insignificant that at the same time this first beast receives its deadly head wound, that the second beast rises in the new world and in time comes to exercise all of the powers of the first beast before it, until it finally causes the earth and them that dwell it therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. It is all too evident that America is changing, just as the scripture indicates that it would as this second or earth beast. As the Roman Empire was once the visible police power of the world, so today America, since World War II, has emerged as the police power of the world and exercises all the power of the first beast before him. 4. We are told that the second beast says to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast, which had the wound by a sword and did live, just to identify it. And he had power to give life to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. In other words, the empire of the city, the Vatican, using the wealth of America through its Federal Reserve coup of the U.S. Treasury, rebuilds the Roman world after World War II, then establishes the United Nations with its headquarters in New York City. In other words, the second beast of Revelation chapter 13, which has its head in Washington, D.C., one of the cities of the empire, creates the image of the first beast, the United Nations, which will eventually require the allegiance of all. This allegiance or worship will be obedience to the United Nations implementation and enforcement of the One World Mark of the Beast monetary system, which will require the participation and numbering of all people, small and great, rich and poor, free and bond. The United Nations is an image through which the Vatican, that is Papal Rome, while it's riding the beast, may vicariously rule the world as it did before its head wound was inflicted. It is an image of what it was even before the rise of the papacy, speaking of the beast, because it will ultimately turn on the apostate whore, and specifically the ten horns will turn on the whore before the consummation. And that's the end of part one of our seventh chapter, Addendum 2017. Part two, interpreting the seven kings of Revelation 17 by the criteria in divinely given interpretation. Yes, I got a little more revelation. I'm so glad I found this book, Key to the Apocalypse, and learning to use this divinely given interpretation. Got a little more insight from one word in the divinely given interpretation. So we're going to apply it and add it to what, well, God has already given the interpretation. And by giving me this little more revelation through this divine interpretation, has verified some things that I thought before, clarified some others, and did a little corrections on some other things, which are barely perceptible. But I always have room for improvement, and I gladly will improve when divine interpretation improves it. So here we go. Chapter 17, verse 10 and 11. And there are seven kings. Five are fallen, and one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. Been a lot of... That's verse 10. A lot of speculation about what, who these seven kings are and how five are fallen and which one is and which one is yet to come. And I've, you know, read a lot of things and through the Hori Apocalypticae and a lot of other guys, even historicists, have got it wrong. But I think we finally got it right, because the clue is in it itself, and the clue is right here. It's this one word, beast. Because this is a two, you know, a two sentence interpretation, a Holy Spirit given interpretation. And there are seven kings, five are fallen, and one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth. Did you catch that? And is of the seven, and goeth into perdition. We just went through four beasts, five beasts in part one. And after going through that, and then the word beast there, it finally clicked in my mind. And I said, these seven kings, or seven powers, seven kingdoms, if you go to the original language, it's not specifically men sitting on a throne like Henry VIII or whatever. The seven kings represent kingdoms or powers. But in the prophecy itself, it tells us what is represented by what these seven kings actually are. They're not singular men, or they're not different types of governing authorities over the Roman Empire. They are beasts. It's right there. It's given in the interpretation for the seven kings is given in the prophecy itself. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and is of the seven, and goes into perdition. So he tells us which one it is. The eighth goes into perdition. Okay, so it's the very last one. We've already figured out by divinely given interpretation that the last power, the one that goes into perdition, is the one that the whore is riding. So it's the Roman Empire being ridden by the whore. Yeah. Boy, she's riding it really well today, ain't she? Everybody jump on. Come on. Doesn't matter what you are. You know, whether you're a shaman, a guru, whether you're a Buddhist or a Native American, everybody jump on. The whore is riding the beast, and everybody's welcome to jump in with it. Islam, Catholics, whatever, Protestant babies, yeah, come on. Evangelicals, whoever you are, just ecumenize with us and jump on the beast with us, because she's riding it right now, and she is in total control of it. And when the whore is riding the beast, and that's how she is at the end, that's the last phase, and we're in it. And if the whore is Papal Rome, the Vatican, and she's riding the beast, that means she is controlling it. Of course, she's going to be killed, and the beast is going to go into perdition after it destroys the whore with fire, and it's specifically the ten horns. Yeah, that's going to be something when that happens. That's going to happen toward the end. We're still waiting for that one to happen, but it's coming. Yeah, Scripture says it will come, so it's coming. And the beast. So now the seven kingdoms, or these seven king powers, are beasts. Settled right here. The clue is right here. How many times did I overlook beast? I underlined it for you all now. There it is. That was and is not, even he is the eighth, and is of the seven, and goeth to perdition. Yes, the beast that is being ridden by the whore is the one that goes to perdition. Even though goes to the beast, the whore goes is destroyed before the beast goes to perdition. That's our chronology given us in the Revelation there. Okay, so let's read on here. First of all, the angel time dates the sixth king, or beast king, as contemporary with John. That is the present Roman Empire. Verse 11 identifies these kings as beasts. So as some believe pagan Rome to be the sixth, and papal Rome to be the seventh, this cannot be for several reasons. One, papal Rome is not a separate beast. It's not an original power in the earth. And two, papal Rome does not merely continue a short space. Remember it says, and the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth. Oh, wait a minute. No, that's not it. Seven kings. Oh, here it is. Got to go back to it here. And the other is not yet. That's the seventh. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. So let's jump back up here. So that's our second power. Where was I? I lost my place here. Okay, jumping back here. Okay, therefore the sixth king is... Oh, I jumped ahead of myself. One, papal Rome is not a separate beast. And two, papal Rome does not merely continue a short space, but in reality far exceeds the space of pagan Rome. Yeah, see? So papal Rome can't be the seventh. That's because a lot of people thought that. And some may still think that. Therefore, the sixth king beast is both Rome pagan and papal. The seventh had not yet come when John wrote it. There's only one additional beast that shows up in the Revelation. Mark it. And that is the second or earth beast of chapter 13. Is it coming together for you now? It's coming together for me. I have to admit, the eighth power goeth into perdition. Therefore must be Rome, one of the seven, therefore also the sixth, because she was contemporary with John. The seventh is a power that shows up for a short space at the end. You're listening to Cross the Border, our Prophecy Reality Edition. We'll be back in a few minutes. Don't go anywhere. The book of Revelation says, "The spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus Christ." This is at the very heart of FirstAmendmentRadio.com. In that spirit, we have created the Prophecy Reality News app for all of your mobile devices, streaming First Amendment Radio 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Available for your Apple, Android device, and smartphone, absolutely free. Get the Prophecy Reality News app installed today, so you can listen to First Amendment Radio wherever you are. The Prophecy Reality News app. Get it now.
The program you are listening to is 100% sponsored by you, the listener, on this First Amendment Rights Media channel. You will notice that there are few commercials on this radio network. There's a good reason for that. Corporate advertising dollars come with strings that limit program content. So without your help, these programs cannot continue on internet or our several affiliates. If you benefit by the educational law programs, we ask you to give. If you are admonished or nurtured by the Bible and ministry programs, we ask you to give. If some voice a cause that you are passionate about, we ask you to give. If you believe in any of these, we ask you to support them as you would a missionary on a continual basis, as if giving a tithe for missionary radio. These programs are not commercially viable and must be supported by those faithful to the cause of truth. Look for the button to sponsor your favorite programs at our listen and schedule pages on the internet. Then, when you subscribe, we will send you the last quarterly MP3 CD of that program immediately, and continue to do so with each new quarter. We will also give you unlimited archive access to all of our programs. We're asking you to give much less than a tithe, so that you may also send support directly to a particular program host, cause, and anywhere else the Spirit may lead you. Do all to the glory of our God and Creator, for His holy nation, the only kingdom that will last forever. Thank you for listening.
Welcome back. You're listening to Cross the Border. We got one more segment to go, and we're going to finish up Key to the Apocalypse. I hope this has been very educational for you. I certainly have been getting an education myself. So glad I found this book and I was continuing my research because I put my other book that I just finished while I researched a lot of these things because I was kind of looking for an end game here. And I think we have found it. And I wrote it as an addendum to the key to the apocalypse and got a little more information on my research into trying to figure out just what is going on with this book of Revelation and why are so many people confused about it. So make sure you do get a copy of my newest book, and you'll find that on my website there. It'll be the top post or one of the top posts there because I just published it a few days ago. But you can buy a copy at Lulu by going to the link on the page there at my website at crosstheborder.org. Just go there, scroll down, and look for when the third temple is built and make sure you get a copy of that. Okay, we're going to finish up here on where we left off on page 92 in The Key to the Apocalypse. Several reasons why pagan Rome can't be the sixth and papal Rome the seventh in the riddle of chapter 17, verses 10 and 11, the seven kings riddle. Okay, because they have to be separate beast powers. Every beast that rises up in the Revelation and the book of Daniel is an original power, was an original power when it rose up. And we find that for all four beasts that rose up from Babylon through Rome, they were all original powers in the earth. They were original in themselves. Even though Rome swallowed the three before it, Rome was original before it swallowed the three before it. It was an original power in the earth. So that means that this earth beast must also, we have to apply what the scripture applies to this new beast power that's introduced. And it has to be a beast power that rises up somewhere else, not in the sea where the other four beasts rose up, but it says it rose up in the symbolic earth. So we find out what is the earth symbolic for, but it's symbolic for a wilderness or a place that is sparsely populated when this earth beast or second beast of Revelation chapter 13 rises up. And we identify it as America. Get the book and read it for yourself and see if you come to the same conclusions, or maybe you could come to a different conclusion. A lot of people have, but I believe that their conclusions are wrong because I'm using divinely given interpretation here and trying my best to apply it. So therefore, the sixth king beast is both Rome pagan and papal. The seventh had not yet come, and there is only one additional beast that shows up in the Revelation, and it is the second or earth beast of chapter 13. Therefore, the seventh, the one that has not yet come, must be this earth beast of the same book, the Revelation, because it is the only other new beast that rises up and was identified in the riddle. Okay? The eighth, it's a power goes to perdition, therefore must be Rome, one of the seven, therefore also the sixth, because she was contemporary with John. The seventh is a power that shows up for a short space, so it can't be papal Rome, because papal Rome has endured for what, 1200, it endured for 1260 years as the ten-horned beast, even though there was an earthquake and a tenth of the kingdom fell, but still, it endured for 1260 years before it received its wound, as it were, to death. Okay? The second, or earth beast, of Revelation 13 must be that power, the seventh power, because it is the only additional beast mentioned in the Revelation. The earth beast fills up a short space when the sea beast, or Rome, is apparently wounded, as it were, to death. Then the seventh, this earth beast, comes alongside Rome, the earth beast, read all about it in chapter 13, comes alongside of Rome, the sea beast, builds an image to it, then all are caused to worship that image on the pain of death, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Daniel gives us the names of the three beasts previous to Rome in his chapter 8. Babylon, Medo-Persia, and Greece. This would require two more before these, plus one yet to come to complete our count. It is about 95 AD when these words were spoken to John. Five kingdoms which once ruled over Israel, and remember, we have Israel, which is a picture of the church. There was the outer court, and then there was the inner court, the remnant, the 7,000 which have not bowed the knee to Baal. See, the physical Israel was a snapshot of the church. The church is a snapshot of physical Israel. There was the visible church, and then there was a remnant, of which God told the prophet, 7,000 have not yet bowed the knee to Baal. So it's about 95 AD when these words were spoken to John. Five kingdoms which once ruled over Israel had fallen. One, Egypt, into which Israel voluntarily entered and was subsequently enslaved by. Two, Assyria took the northern kingdom after Israel split. Three, Babylon, which completely dissolved Israel's self-rule. Four was Medo-Persia, conquered Babylon, and was followed by Greece. You know, that guy Alexander the Great, that one notable horn. Okay? Conquered by the terrible Iron Beast. Six, Rome. The and one is current with John in 95 AD. Seven is America, and the other is not yet come. America, the seventh kingdom, developed in the New World about the same time Papal Rome received its wound by the sword. It is not recorded that this seventh, America, conquers the one before it or falls to a successor, only that it continues a short space. This will make perfect sense, and I should have deleted that sentence there because it fit in the book. See, and this is a quote from my other book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. And eight is Rome, after the wound, as it were to death, was healed, is aided by number seven, who is also the second beast of Revelation chapter 13. And that is the end of the key to the apocalypse. That's the end of it. So there you have it. Key to the apocalypse. And let's go down there so you can see the whole cover there. Key to the apocalypse. Yes, this is the, you're looking at the PDF version that I'm offering on online there. And let me just go over, since we have a few minutes here. Put my pledge in there. I put that in all of our across the border publishings there. This is, what is it? Did you copyright across the border publishing? There you go. Always put our, I pledge allegiance to the King of Kings and to his kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. One holy nation under the heavenly Father with grace, mercy, and justice for all. And I would take advantage of that grace and that mercy. Because if you don't, justice is bad news. Nobody wants to pay the price for their own sins. Unfortunately, that is the choice that most people on earth choose. That's the many are on the broad way that leads to destruction. Just make sure you're not one of them. Take advantage of the grace and mercy. And then when justice comes, you'll receive the justice for his imputed righteousness that he imputes to you by that grace and mercy. Oh, take advantage of it, please. That's the gospel. That's the good news, you know, is repent. and be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and start walking that repentance road. Get on that narrow way that leads to life and take advantage of that grace and mercy and receive the justice that belongs only to the Son of God and only to you by His blood being applied to your sin account and erasing it completely. Don't be a fool like the many that are on the broad way to destruction saying, I don't need no Jesus. You know, that's just a crutch, that religion stuff. I don't need no one to pay my sins. I don't need a savior. That's what the world thinks. That's what they say in their pride. They don't want nothing from Jesus. But I'll tell you what, if you don't get His blood covering your sins, then you're going to pay the price for your own sins. And boy, you don't want to be there. Don't want to go there, because you cannot, as there will be no escape for you. He is the only way. He is the only way to the Father. He is the only way, you know. Thieves and robbers try to get in by another door, but there is no other door. He said, I am the door. No man comes to the Father but by me. So confess, repent of your sins, and allow His Holy Spirit to teach you obedience. Voluntarily walk in His kingdom. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. He didn't say, if you keep my commandments, you'll love me. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. So love Him first, and He will teach you how to keep His commandments. Because nobody can work their way. You can never be good enough to purchase your way out of death. Because you just don't have the blood for it. It's only His blood that will, being applied to your account, that will free you from sin and death that comes from it. There you go. Okay. Yeah, this is going to go over the what we just did, the key to the apocalypse there. I was going to, the preface there by H. Grattan Guinness. Read that. That's a good thing to read. Well, that's it. You've seen it all now. The entire key to the apocalypse. And I got a few minutes to just kill here. And no other news or anything like that going on here. But we're going to keep an eye on the news we did have earlier. That's wow. Yeah. Trump's son-in-law to broker Mideast peace. And the guy is a what do you call it? Orthodox Jew. Yeah, that's right. Orthodox Judaism. They're the ones who believe that, I think they might change your belief. You read my, get my book. When the third temple is built, the rapture play will begin, because I cover all of that about why even Orthodox Jews will drop the requirement for the animal sacrifice taking place on the Temple Mount and drop the requirement that the Dome of the Rock must be demolished. Because there's diehard Orthodox out there. But I think most of your mainstream, especially someone like this, an American Orthodox, maybe, you know, but they're going to try to get it. But of course, we know that how the play is written in advance. And so I think you'll like my book a lot. The third temple is built. The rapture play will begin. And see if we can get over here to the table of contents. Chapter 1 from the beginning. And what I do there is I go to the Bible and show you where the sacrifice is and give you a history on the sacrifice. And hopefully you'll find that interesting. And then I show you where the sacrifice begins. And then we talk about building the third temple and the movement for building the third temple when that starts in the 1980s. Chapter 2, learning the lines. We got to learn the lines about the rapture play. So we're learning our lines for the play about to begin. Because, you know, before you can go on stage and before you can, you know, get all your actors together, they all got to learn their lines, don't you? And all the people have learned their lines. I learned the lines. I read the late great Planet Earth. And I watched the Left Behind movies, you know? So learning the lines, right? And the seven-year tribulation, we go about that. We talk about version confusion. That's to get people more indoctrinated so, you know, they can learn the lines. And we tell you why you're learning the lines. We have the final edit before the play goes on. And then we talk about the leading role. That's what we're talking about, perhaps, with, you know, with an article like this. You know, how's this going to play out? You know, is this guy, are they going to put this guy up for the, you know, because if he comes up with this treaty, if he brokers this treaty for a seven-year treaty to, you know, wow. You know, it's starting to happen, it seems. So you definitely want to get this book and read all about it. So the leading role. And so we got the leading role settled, and we say, let the show begin. And chapter 4, the stage is set. And we talk about a sure interpretation and what's wrong with the play and how it's going to play out, why it's going to play out that way, and why it's different than reality. Talk about the New Testament temple, and I gave you guys a preview of that a couple months ago. And then we talk about what happens after the play. And then we go into identifying history and prophecy. We talk about the six vials so we can find our place where we are now. And then we go through chapter 6, filling in the blanks. And we talk about the three frogs. That's a sub part of the chapter. And then chapter 7, which we just covered here today. I add as chapter 7 in my newest book, so it's there. I wrote that chapter for both books actually, because I wanted to finish my when the third temple is built, and so all of this research goes into it, and I just put the addendum in there. And going forward in faith, and because I had to fill up 100 pages, I also updated and put the latest update as my what year is it as an appendix, and did a little better, so the graphics are a little bit better, and added that in there as an appendix, because when you publish a book, you pay for 100 pages no matter what. Okay, because that's what they charge you for. That's the minimum they do. So might as well use them. Right? And actually, it went up to 111 pages, so not much more than that by the time I got done. So, and I thought this would be good for a lot of people that just get this book, so they know how many years we have, what to expect, about how many years we have for this thing to play out. So nobody has to be going, oh my goodness, am I going to be raptured? And Jesus could come at any minute. And all of that nonsense. And the return of Christ is imminent. Well, if it's a rapture, it's imminent, because it's a secret, right? So, but the fact is, not all of the calamity of the entire book of Revelation, like the futurists say, is going to happen in the last 3.5 or 7 years, right before Christ returns. This calamity, thank God, has played out over 2,000 years. All of the vials and all of the plagues and all of that has played out over the last 2,000 years. It isn't just going to be dumped on the last three. It's like God waited 2,000 years and nothing happened. No, you know, get the Hori Apocalypticae, get my Hori Apocalypticae 2015, the abridgment of E.B. Eliot's great 2,500 page work. And just read that abridgment and you go, well, you know, this kind of makes sense. Yeah, it kind of makes sense. All right, we have run out of time for today. May the Almighty bless you as you continue to walk in His kingdom. Be one of the few and not one of the many.
The program you are listening to is 100% sponsored by you, the listener, on this First Amendment Rights Media channel. You will notice that there are few commercials on this radio network. There's a good reason for that. Corporate advertising dollars come with strings that limit program content. So without your help, these programs cannot continue on internet or our several affiliates. If you benefit by the educational law programs, we ask you to give. If you are admonished or nurtured by the Bible and ministry programs, we ask you to give. If some voice a cause that you are passionate about, we ask you to give. If you believe in any of these, we ask you to support them as you would a missionary on a continual basis, as if giving a tithe for missionary radio. These programs are not commercially viable and must be supported by those faithful to the cause of truth. Look for the button to sponsor your favorite programs at our listen and schedule pages on the internet. Then, when you subscribe, we will send you the last quarterly MP3 CD of that program immediately and continue to do so with each new quarter. We will also give you unlimited archive access to all of our programs. We're asking you to give much less than a tithe so that you may also send support directly to a particular program host, cause, and anywhere else the Spirit may lead you. Do all to the glory of our God and Creator, for His holy nation, the only kingdom that will last forever. Thank you for listening.